This presentation is going to take you through some standard presentation do's and don'ts, and it should be seen in concert with the PowerPoint do's and don'ts that I've made and uploaded as well. So the first thing that you should be thinking about when you're presenting is to speak, don't read. And I want to say this isn't actually in the PowerPoint itself, but I want to emphasize that you should never have paper notes or an iPad or a cell phone with you that you're reading from and or even referencing. And the reason is that every time you look at it, it creates a barrier between you and your audience, and you absolutely don't want that, because if they feel that barrier, they will disconnect from you. And really, it's the same thing with PowerPoint. The PowerPoint is almost always going to be behind you or maybe to the side of you, and you want to almost completely ignore it. In other words, what PowerPoint? So what you want to do is actually use the PowerPoint as a background to your speech, and it should be there and it should be interesting and all of those things, but you never want to turn around and look at it. You don't even want to look at it on your screen in front of you. And of course, you should always have a screen in front of you that shows you the PowerPoint, so you never are worried about what's on the screen. And you should always use it as if it is a prop, but not a prop that is absolutely necessary. So occasionally you might turn a little bit and point to something on the screen, but usually you're just gonna be pointing behind you rather than actually turning around, and we'll get to that in a bit. So the second thing is to constantly be excited, and that doesn't mean to be bubbly and crazy and whatever. It means to have passion. It means to act like you want to be there. Even if you're terrified to speak publicly, even if you absolutely do not want to be there doing a job interview or doing a presentation or, you know, justifying why you need a budget increase or why they shouldn't fire you or fire your employees, your direct reports, you need to make it seem as if you're excited to present, or you're excited to have the opportunity to present to the audience. Because the audience will feel that and they will respond to you positively because of it. The third point is that you should lose yourself. And by this I mean try to take out as much of your ego as possible. You are not there for yourself, you are there for the audience. In other words, you are excited to have the opportunity to present to them. And that doesn't mean that you don't include anything about yourself. It doesn't mean you don't have any kind of personal branding or personal flair or refer to yourself. But the presentation isn't about you, even if you are applying for the job. Instead, the presentation is how you can add to your audience's wants and needs, even if they don't know that they have those wants and needs. And the fourth point here is to embrace us, embrace the audience. In other words, you shouldn't act as if there is an artificial barrier between yourself and the audience. You really need to emphasize the idea that you are including us in the presentation. And the more that you know about us, of course, the better there. So if you can actually refer to our careers, our pasts, our connections, in always a positive, of course, respectful way, include us in the thing. If you can just have them hold up their hands if they've seen something, or whatever you want to get them involved, the more that you do that, the better. Of course, you don't want this to be completely call or response or completely participatory unless you want it to be fun and seem like acting. But in any case, you can do little things to integrate us into the presentation. So the next big step is move. And I've included some pictures here that might help you visualize this a little bit. But what I want to emphasize is that we are all ADHD predators. Human beings are predators. Our biology makes us predators. And so you need to keep our attention in the way that you would a predator's. So look at this image here of a tiger. Notice that his eyes are in front, and just like our eyes. And what that suggests is that he's interested in depth, he's interested in speed, he's interested in movement. All of those things are what you should draw on when you're trying to keep a predator interested in you. Notice as well that it's very difficult to look away from the tiger's eyes. And that's because when you're making eye contact, it creates a bond, even if it's a picture, that allows you to capitalize on the attention. And really what that means is that you are discussing dominance or emphasizing dominance. Now, what's important here is that dominance does not mean aggression necessarily. Dominance means confidence. Now, if you bring aggression with that dominance, meaning you hold eye contact too long, it could feel like this, or it could result in this from your audience, and you need to be very careful about that. So the correct way to do eye contact is a couple of seconds, up to about 5 or 6 seconds, maybe 7 seconds, will be okay. Because if you go longer than that, it's either aggressive in this kind of violent way, or a different kind of violence, the creepy stare. And you absolutely do not want that in the presentation, or in general. So the third point is that you should walk around. And by walk around, I don't mean pace. You don't want to look like a lion in a cage or something like that. But you should stay away from your central screen PowerPoint that you would be looking at. You should walk from the left-hand side of where your audience is to the right-hand side of where your audience is. You don't want to walk further in either direction from where your audience stops. And when you walk to the audience on the left, let's say, you can look at them, but you should also look and spend more time looking at the audience on the other side of the room. In other words, your shoulders, the flat part of your shoulders and chest should be facing at that point the person to the far right of the room. And the same thing, if you walk to the left, to the right of the room, you would be facing the person on the left. And you might talk to the people that are near you, but you should talk even more to the people on the other side of the room, because otherwise the people on that side will feel excluded. So the fourth point here is to face us, right? And this means that you are trying to create exchange with us, and that is through body language, meaning keeping your body open and facing us, but also that you are not showing disinterest or fear, right? If you turn and show your shoulders to us, that's a measure of disinterest. If you turn your back to us, it's disrespect or fear. If you take a look at this image here, kind of threw this in for fun, this is a tiger when a tiger trainer jumped into a pool in the tiger training facility. The tiger just instinctively chases, it runs after you. And so in this case, it wasn't necessarily a horrible thing, because they worked very well together, but it could be very negative. And I would say it's the same thing with your audience. If your audience senses that you're really insecure, if they sense that you cannot connect with them, then they might actually respond in the way a predator would respond to prey. And you absolutely do not want that. And the fifth point here is that you need to manage group presentations well. In public relations, in communications fields, strategic comm, marketing, you often do group presentations. The worst thing you can do is to do a group presentation badly. And here are a couple of things that often happen with group presentations. The first thing is that it looks like you're playing musical chairs. Everybody's up in the front of the room, and they all are kind of jockeying for position, and maybe one person will step up a little bit to speak and then step back. And what this often does is it leads to the second problem, which is that it seems like you're playing whack-a-mole. In other words, one person comes up, briefly steps forward and says something, then steps back. Then the next person comes up and says something, then the first person, then the third person, then the fifth person, and you don't want that. What you want is for us to understand the flow of the presentation, meaning one person should be in front of us at a time. The other people that are presenting should be over to the side, and then you'll switch off. So let's say they're waiting in the left-hand side of the room, and you're in the middle. They come up to meet you, and then you move to the right. And then they present, and then again, it's like playing a relay race. You don't want to go back to the group, because then people never know if you're going to actually come back. And what you want to do is really show with your the way the group appears how far along the presentation we are. You want to make us feel some structure. Step three is to dress like you mean it. And this is surprisingly important. You might not understand how important this is, actually, but it's really important for two main reasons. One, that the audience is half the battle. In other words, if you're dressed in a really, really fancy suit, but your audience is more casual, that's going to be threatening to them. On the other hand, if you're in a C-suite at a boardroom, and you are presenting and you're in a flannel and pajama pants, and they're all in suits, it just doesn't make sense, right? So you have to really think about the brand of the audience and what kinds of things you should be wearing to fit in with that audience. And the reason for that is that you don't want them to really remember your dress. You want them to remember you. You want them to not look at your whatever. You want them to be looking at the presentation, thinking about you, thinking about the presentation, looking at your face, especially your hands, your movements, rather than what you're wearing. And so the best way to do that is to just fit in, to assimilate with the audience. The other issue here is that your mind is the other half of that battle. In other words, if you're giving an interview, let's say over the phone, you should often wear a suit. You should dress formally. And the reason is that your mind actually changes the way it behaves, your attitude, and of course it changes the way you speak and the way you move and all of those things when you dress in a certain way. And so it's the same thing with a presentation, obviously. You need to dress the way that you would want people to view you, not the way that you necessarily think of yourself. And the reason for both of these, or at least part of the reason for both of these, is that you need to think about where we're looking. Are you looking at our face? Are you looking at our hands? Are you looking at our movements? Or are you looking at our cleavage? Are you looking at how great our shoes are? Are you looking at how tight or how loose our clothing is? How out of date our clothing is, etc. So you shouldn't be incredibly stylish, unless you are, for instance, giving a presentation in for fashion, although even then, I wouldn't say you would want to be at the edge of fashion. You would want to tone it down a little bit, because otherwise, everybody's going to be looking at what you're wearing. And unless you're presenting what you're wearing, that's not what you want. You want them listening to you, thinking about what you're saying, considering, not having any kind of distraction. Remember, we're predators. So if you flash some shiny objects around, then we're going to look at those and not at you. So the final point is here, what should we remember? When somebody leaves your presentation, do they remember you, who you are, what your brand is, or do they remember your new Air Jordans? Do they remember your really flashy earrings or your nose ring or whatever? Do they remember your tattoos, etc.? Or do they remember who you are? And of course, you want them to remember your presentation, what you talked about, and who you are, nothing else. So step four is to know your technology. And you'd think that this would be simple, but in fact, this leads to a lot of problems with presentations, and I see it all the time. The first, of course, is to spell check. Absolutely use PowerPoint's internal spell check feature. Don't just look for that little red line underneath, because you need to do it again. And with this little line here, I've given us two spell check issues. One is A-G-I-A-N as opposed to A-G-A-I-N again. And the problem with that is that when you type this the first time, often the little red line doesn't appear underneath it to show you that it's a spelling mistake. So you must do the spell check to make sure you catch these. The other is if. Spell check obviously won't catch if, even though it's supposed to be it, because it is a correct word. And of course, this is a huge issue with where, there. And of course, my personal pet peeve, it's and its. It apostrophe S meaning it is, and its meaning it's possessive, like it's ball, it's computer, etc. So you absolutely want to make sure that those things do not interfere with your presentation, because when I'm watching a presentation and I see something like that, that is all I think about, is how unprofessional it is, not the content of the presentation. And you've lost me there for maybe a few minutes, maybe the whole presentation. The third point here, or really the second point, is to preview on a big screen. If you are showing on a big screen, make sure that you preview on a big screen, because it's going to look different. The colors are going to look different, and they look different on a TV and on a projector, or different kinds of projectors. The scale is going to be different, maybe the formatting is going to be different, and absolutely, if you have any kinds of images, the images will look very pixelated if they're small images, and they might look great on your screen, but they might look horrible when they're projected large. And this is especially when you're giving a talk at something like TED and it's blown up really big. The third major point here is clickers are your friend. You should have a clicker always with you. If you don't have one, buy one. And you should present with the clicker. That should allow you to go forward in with a slide, back in a slide, and then to black out the screen as well. I prefer to have those so that if you want to black it out, you can. And so in this case, what you want to do is remember that you don't need to be tied to the computer, and in fact, you should avoid being tied to the computer as much as possible. Now, one caveat to that is that when you have a computer in front of you, you should be using presenter view and having your monitor extended. In other words, you don't want to duplicate the displays. You want to have it projected as an extended display to the projector, and have your monitor be the primary display. And the reason for that is with PowerPoint, the new PowerPoints, you have what's called presenter view, and it looks like this. What you see here, notice that this image is actually a little pixelated. Hopefully you can see it on your screen, because this is a small image. So if this was presented really big, it would look horrible. But what you can see here is that you've got your current slide, the big screen here. You've got to the right on the top, you've got the next slide, or in fact, the next click. So even if you have a bunch of animations like I do on these slides, it'll show you the next point, not your next slide. And then at the bottom, you actually have a notes section so you can see your notes. I would strongly recommend only having at most an outline in the notes and not having the whole script. That can be a real problem. In fact, it's been a problem for me when I've spoken, when I did my TED talk. I left them there because I changed my speech at the last minute. And of course, I spend a little bit more time than I would have liked to looking at that rather than connecting to my audience. So presenter view is a really key thing, and it's what you should really use with your presentations. So the fifth and final step is to know your audience. Just like with creating a PowerPoint presentation, presenting itself is all about knowing your audience. Tone is really important. You must understand who your audience is to be able to know whether you can be funny, be friendly, demure, be depressed, be energetic and bubbly, be exciting, all of those things. Tone is really important, and that must connect to your story. You can't have anything unless you have a good story. Any PowerPoint, whether you're giving the latest financial results for your corporation, or whether you're doing trying to raise money for your nonprofit, or whether you're trying to discuss the downfall of education in the United States, any of those kinds of things, story is the most important thing, and everything else follows from that. The third point is really working with your audience. You must show respect for them, and you must be open to them. And by respect, I mean know where they're coming from. Don't be angry if they have a different point of view. Allow them to interject if they need to, and if they start to get a little insistent about it, or if they start to heckle or something like that, simply say thank you for your feedback. We'll deal with that during a question answer session at the end of the presentation. But allow some kind of feedback, and don't make it seem as if you are completely shutting them out of the process. You need to be able to demonstrate that you respect them. And the fourth point here is that demographics matter. So presenting to baby boomers and presenting to millennials is a very different thing. Millennials are going to be interested in a different kind of design, a different kind of color. They might be interested in someone that speaks a little faster. They might be interested in having a lot of graphics or images or videos. They might not be interested in any of those things. It really depends on who they are. So you need to really look at your demographic, look at your stakeholders, do a profile of those stakeholders. In other words, what would they like to see in a presentation? And then build your presentation accordingly. And the final point here is that while demographics matter, intent matters more. If you're the same person giving the same presentation in two different places, with two different demographics, if you mean well, if you're trying to integrate them, if you're trying to bring them in, if you respect them, they will sense that. If you are not feeling in those ways, you should not do the presentation, because audiences can definitely sense that intent. You want to make them feel positive, and you want them to feed off of your positivity. Even if you're talking about something sad or depressing, you should still be a positive human being and positive about doing the presentation. So I hope this is helpful, and good luck with your presentations.